Hello, my name is Guy de la Bedwyer, British historian and writer. Welcome to my channel. Today, I'm going to be reviewing this book. Okay, let's get straight down to business. It's called Ancient Rome in 50 Monuments. It's by Paul Roberts, who is research keeper in the Department of Antiquities at the Ashmolean Museum of Art and Archaeology in Oxford. And it's published in April 2024 by Thames and Hudson. Now, there's lots of books on Rome, and I'm embarrassed to admit my own book on Rome comes out in April this year as well, Populus, which I've mentioned in another video. That's all about the experience of being Roman and living in the city of Rome. And this book, however, is actually about the monuments. Now, I've got to admit, you know, some of you will remember me from Channel 4's Time Team when I most of the time dealt with Roman sites. And of course, what we were looking at was a remote Roman province on the very edge of the Roman Empire. But one always had in the back of one's mind, of course, that Rome itself, the city of Rome, was the centre of that empire, an empire that existed for good or ill. People criticise it, but also praise it in other ways. There's lots of different attitudes towards it. One thing that there is absolutely no doubt about is that Rome was the preeminent city in the ancient world, whether you like it or not. It was a phenomenally wealthy, powerful, overcrowded, incredibly lavish and extravagant place, but also filled with hideous squalor and poverty. And the monuments, which is really what this book is about, and this book is about surviving monuments, monuments that you can actually go and see, they were the features of ancient Rome that overwhelmed everybody. And there is a fantastic story from the middle of the 4th century AD when Constantius II, the emperor, who'd never been to Rome before, he was the son of Constantine I, he comes to Rome, and the historian Ammianus Marcellinus describes Constantius's reaction to seeing the phenomenal state of ancient Rome, which by then really had all its monuments, and dating back some of them hundreds and hundreds of years, but mostly intact at that date. Of course, they're all largely ruinous now. But let's have a look at the book. So, like all Thames and Hudson products, it's a very nicely manufactured book. It's nice to hold. And if we open the cover straight away, interestingly, something I chose to do myself, there's an old map of ancient Rome. This looks as if it's been taken from an older engraving. And these are often much more attractive than modern plans, as well as, I've got to say, much cheaper to use. Now, if we flick into the book straight away, we can see, if we look at the contents, beginnings from brick to marble, which is a reference to Augustus, who claimed to have found Rome brick and made it marble. New builders, Roman glory, an uncertain city from old to new. And then there's an epilogue, the aftermath. So the structure of this book is broadly chronological. Typically for a Thames and Hudson book, it's absolutely packed with illustrations. And they range from, these are some modern reconstruction here, for example, down in the Forum. And if we go back over there to this, for example, is the Forum of Rome. And this is quite clearly in the style of a very famous British artist called Alan Sorrell, who did it, long dead now, who did a huge number of painted reconstructions. And although they're often quite, I suppose, rough looking in appearance compared to modern digitally created reconstructions, there's something quite artistic about it. And those of you who watched Channel 4's Time Team will remember well Victor Ambrus, the artist, who had a very distinctive style in which he showed people going about their business in and amongst the various ancient buildings that we might have been excavating of whatever date. And very sort, sometimes sketchy, but with a lot of dynamic movement. And Alan Sorrell's drawings often have elements of that, although quite characteristically quite dark and gloomy in places, something sort of slightly sinister about them. There's also old engravings here, for example, and that shows the output of the Cloaca Maxima, the great sewer in Rome. And there is the occasional plan. That is the Forum of Trajan. I suppose I would have to say, in this book's case, it's a bit short on actual building plans, And that would make more sense of some of the structures. And there are quite a lot of juxtapositions there, for example. So this is the forum of well, it's called the Forum of Nerva, but it was actually the Forum of Domitian, but got renamed. That shows it in a sort of later Roman state there in a painting down there, and that's part of it today. That's a little bit that still survives. It's called Il Colonnace, which is Italian for those wretched little columns, and you can see those right by a very busy street close to the Temple of Mars Ultor. And if we flick over to here, something that I've marked, and this is the Porticus of Octavia, and you've got an old painting of it there, still stuffed into relatively modern buildings, which was so typical in Rome. So many of the ancient structures got absorbed into buildings later on. It's now been cleared, but it's just the entrance. The porticus has gone, and the porticus is a little bit difficult to explain. The porticus is not something that we really have today, but it's like a kind of religious leisure centre. So the central feature is a temple. These were there were at least two of these in Augustan Rome. There was one of Octavia is Augustus's sister, and there was also the porticus of Livia, who was Augustus's wife, and that's completely disappeared. All we've got here is the entrance to the porticus of Octavia, although that's even that is a complete total rebuild in Septimius Severus's time, thanks to it being destroyed by fire. That's why it's got this rather strange appearance with the arch on the side. You can go and see that. A porticus was a place that had libraries and gardens, and it's really kind of an opportunity for ordinary people to have the chance to walk in a kind of ele experience elegant living, if you like. It's as much a public park and leisure centre as it is a religious focus. And then over here, for example, under Hadrian, something that most people don't even bother to notice, this is an apartment building, and it's just by the Capitoline Hill, and it's amazing how many people just, well, most of them just drive past it in coaches. Very few people walk past it and see it, but that's actually one of the very few relics in ancient Rome of the sort of building that most ordinary people would have lived in, right in the heart of the city. Of course, you've got the baths, and that looks to me very much like another Alan Sorrell drawing there, well, painting there. This is the Baths of Diocletian. Now, yes, that's right. Now, the Baths of Diocletian are just opposite Termini Station. And there's a church very nearby, which actually still has the Frigidarium. And there you can see it in that picture there. And it was rearranged by, remodeled by Michelangelo. And you can walk into it, and it's utterly, totally magnificent. And there's an engraving of some of the remains around it. There's a remarkable amount of that that survives to this day. So this book is, oh gosh, I must show you that. That's the Temple of Venus in Rome. And there is Sol, originally a colossus of Nero. And that, of course, is the statue after which the Colosseum is named. And the Colosseum is not so named because it was colossal. It was because it was right next to a colossus. Of course, that's long since gone. You can see the podium of the Temple of Venus in Rome. And this is a view, I suppose, just about from if you were looking at it from the Colosseum. And that's a modern reconstruction drawing. So the text takes you through all sorts of different aspects of this. There's various details. There's some box outs there. There's one, for example, about marble in Rome. There's the odd quotation from an ancient author. So it's a very attractive book to look at, and I haven't read it all yet by any means, but it's obviously going to be a place to browse through and look at from time to time. My personal advice would be, though, and he does actually mention the author of this book, Amanda Claridge, the late Amanda Claridge, who I was lucky enough to meet once at Ostia. She was leading a university tour group that happened to include one of my own ex-classical civilization students who'd gone on to read the subject at university. So she actually signed my earlier copy of this. This is a later edition. And this is called Rome, an Oxford Archaeological Guide. Now, what I'm actually looking at and reviewing here is this book, which incidentally says on the back, a sweeping new history of the city of Rome told through 50 monuments and the emperors who built them to make their mark on the greatest capital of the classical world. But I also think it's worth having this book, because this book is full of a great deal of very detailed history and plans, which are best for using if you're walking around Rome itself. So I think that if you're really interested in this, and if you want to go to Rome, this is a great book for giving you various ideas of the things you might want to visit. Now, it does say 50 monuments. There's no way you're going to be able to visit 50 monuments in a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks. You know, you'd need a lifetime in Rome. I've been to Rome lots of times, and of course I end up often going to the same places and try and fit in some new things, but there's always something new. I imagine that over the years I have been to practically all of the monuments mentioned in this book, because they are visible, they are accessible, and as he points out, some of them are free to view, some of them are ticketed. You are going to have to pay to get in to see them. That's, for example, the Palatine Hill, or in the Forum of Rome, and you're going to have to pay to get into the Colosseum and various other bits. But a lot of it you can see for free. This is a great book for giving you ideas. But if you can't get to Rome, if you're not in a position to be able to go there, and the truth of the matter is that Rome is an expensive and very congested city, and since COVID it's become a great deal more crowded. The last time I went was actually in the autumn of 2020, just as the pandemic waned for a bit and there was a bit of reopening. We went to Rome for about 4 or 5 days, and I've got to tell you, it was paradise, because the place was practically empty. So we were able to walk around many of the monuments in a way we hadn't been able to for years and years and years. I'm not sure I'm going to be rushing to go back, but this book makes a very good armchair visit to ancient Rome. It really does. This is a way that you can appreciate and enjoy it. But I've got to say, actually, even Amanda Claridge's book, this archaeological guide, that is an endless browse for me. I'm sorry this copy's so battered, but it has been honourably carted around Rome on numerous occasions. I think that this one is not a book you would probably want to cart round. It's one that is worth reading and enjoying and looking at beforehand, then arming yourself with that, booking your flights if you can run to it, and going out to the city of Rome and exploring it. And of all the cities in the world, Rome is truly overwhelming. Rome is Rome. It's a stupid thing to say, I suppose. I often go to London. I live in Britain. London is an utterly fascinating city too. It's never boring, and I find that Rome and London are comparable in that, although they couldn't actually be more different. I'd also recommend, if you do manage to get out there, to go to the port at Ostia, at Ostia Antica, which is very easy to visit. You can hop on to take the metro down to Pyramid, which is also featured in here. That's the Pyramid of Cestius, a massive funerary monument built into the Aurelian walls of Rome. That's nicely described in here too. And you can take the Lido di Ostia train all the way down and get out at Ostia Antica and go and see the ruins of the port of Rome, which have a lot of the apartment buildings and temples and other structures of the type that ordinary people occupied in Rome that mostly don't survive today. But you can walk up and down genuine Roman streets, which you can do in Rome sometimes, actually. But not all the time, because most of them are buried. So there we are. Just to recap, that is Paul Roberts, Ancient Rome in 50 Monuments. As I said earlier, it happens to coincide with my own populace. So there's the places that people walked around and saw in the monuments in Rome. That's about their everyday lives. And then the late Amanda Claridge's A Remarkable Archaeological Guide to Rome. I would certainly say that's absolutely indispensable. This is a great browse and read. And if you happen to pick up my copy of my book Populous, then that'll give you some of the background colour. So I hope that gives you a bit of a flavour. As so often, and I think back to those time team digs in Britain, looking at rather wrecky looking trenches with people jumping up and down in excitement because there was a piece of pottery in there. And then if you ever get to go to Rome and you see things like Trajan's Column or the gateway to the Porticus of Octavia, or very close to it, and again described in here, the Theatre of Marcellus, which was a begun by Julius Caesar, finished off by Augustus, and in the name of his nephew, who was going to die young, his intended heir. And that is a remarkable thing, because the whole of the auditorium, the back of the theatre, the arcades, they survive, and they've got flats at the top there. And that's one thing I would say, I suppose, a lot of the photographs in here are rather sort of strangely... there's nobody in sight. There's the Pyramid of Cestius that I mentioned earlier on, and I'm sure that if I look up at the back, that if I find the Theatre of Marcellus, yes, I can do that. That's on page 72-7. If I just find it that there, and there we are. That is the Theatre of Marcellus, and you can see there's flats around the top, so that's all built in Augustus's time. Now, in my experience, there's always lots of people walking up and down there. Don't be fooled. Rome is incredibly busy. But anyway, this is the sort of thing that's where the Roman world comes from. So when you're looking at the grotty little remains of the footings of a wall of a villa in Britain, it's always quite sobering to think that this was all governed from this remarkable city, and that in modern Rome today there are so many of these monuments, albeit somewhat derelict in places, and you can see that's very battered, as you might expect, and that bit of a temple there is extremely heavily restored from bits and pieces. But you know, there's not a street corner in Rome that hasn't got something of interest. Absolutely fascinating. I mean, I just think off the top of my head, actually, that near the Pantheon, the domed temple, which is one of the most famous buildings of all in Rome, just up a side street, there's a monumental foot from a statue of the god Serapis, who was a combination of Osiris and Apis, came from Egypt, really from the Ptolemaic period, and it's just sitting up a side street, and virtually nobody ever notices it at all. So, I mean, Rome is it's not just these, as he says himself, as Paul Roberts says, this is just a tiny selection. You know, there's a vast number of things. Anyway, there you go. 2024, April, Thames and Hudson. It is available on Amazon. And just in case you're wondering, no one's paid me to write this review or speak this review. That's a copy of the book. I've had a look through it, and that's what I think of it so far. So I hope you found that interesting. Thank you very much.